NCUA board member Michael Frizell discussed the outcome of the monthly board meeting with the Credit Union Times here at the NCUA headquarters. Board member Frizell, I want to thank you for taking time to speak with us after the board meeting today.
I'm glad to be here, Nick.
First, I wanted to ask about the risk-based capital rule. Why do you think this rule is necessary for credit unions?
Well, I think the time has come, Nick, for us to put forward a proposed rule for this purpose. The banks got the Basel. The credit unions don't have that, but we have to be comparable to what the banks do. And I think by putting out this capital rule, as the chairman talked about, the fact that if some credit unions had more capital, the ones we had problems with in the past and that have failed, if they had the capital then that we're talking about now, the loss to the insurance fund would have been much less, and perhaps even some of these credit unions may have been able to survive. So I think it's time that a proposed rule is put out there. The industry give us their comments as to how we can make it better, but it's time that credit unions start looking at more capital.
The credit union trade organizations have made the case that the credit unions were left out of Dodd-Frank in terms of the mandate for risk-based capital. They also say there should be a legislative solution to risk-based capital instead of something through the NCUA. How do you respond to that criticism?
Well, the omission from Dodd-Frank really doesn't matter a lot when you consider that they need greater capital to continue to operate in the financial sector. As to whether it should be a legislative fix, we can't wait for Congress to act on everything because Congress is really too busy with a lot of other things. And this may never happen or never come forward in the time that's needed to consider this type of proposal and really act on it. I think the NCUA board has said this needs to be done now. We have the authority to do so, and we're going to move forward to do it.
Now, on the derivatives rule that was finalized at the meeting, you raised some concerns about the cost. You were saying during the meeting there are additional costs that weren't specifically outlined in the rule. Could you talk a little bit more about those costs and how credit unions may react to this final rule?
During the course of all of this, Nick, the credit unions didn't want to have to pay an application fee or a continued annual fee if they were involved in a derivative program. The trades said that everybody should basically pay for this. We should not have any type of special fees for this. So I just wanted the industry to know what this program is going to cost in total. The $750,000 is basically the first year cost for outside resourcing of things that may be needed. When I raised a point with Larry Fazio, the head of our E&I unit, as to what is going to really actual cost going to be, the fact that we're devoting six individuals to this program, which their cost, with all their related costs, is about $1.9 million a year, which then takes the program total cost for the first year approximately $2.6 million. And that's fine. This is what the derivative program is going to cost. I just wanted the industry to know that whether you're involved in a program or not, all credit unions will be paying for it. And I just wanted them to know the exact amount that the program is going to cost.
Now, in terms of the proposed rule and then the final rule, the costs were less in the final rule language compared to the proposed rule, but you're saying it could actually go up over time.
What was less, Nick, was the actual cost of the outside resourcing. It was originally estimated to be about $1.5 million. Staff brought that down to $750,000 for the first year. So that was the reduction that you saw for that rule. All I wanted to be done was in total inclusion as to what the total staff cost would be so that they know what the cost is of the derivative program.
And you made a comment about a TV show comparing, you know, your reservations to the rule, but that credit unions wanted this. Could you, you expand on that?
Credit unions have been asking for this for quite some time. And so we put this forward as a proposed rule and then now as a final rule being passed. But they felt that this type of product, investment product, would be good for them. It would help in relation to their risk. It would help them earn additional money. So it was a good idea. And I thought to myself, well, okay, I likened it to the fact of this TV show that many years ago people would write in and say, we'd like to see this. And so I likened that to the derivative rule, and the title of that program was You Asked For It. So the credit unions asked for it, and now we've given it to them to go ahead and make the best use of it.
Now, an issue I wanted to move on to outside of the board meeting is the late filers of call reports.
Yes.
The letter went out to credit unions saying that the NCUA is going to impose fines, penalties on them if they don't file on time. Do you think that was the best way to deal with late filers, the penalties?
I think every NCUA has tried everything other than imposing fines. We've had examiners go out to late filers. We've sent late filers letters saying, you're late, please get your report in. That hasn't worked. Perhaps by assessing fines, it will work. I saw in one of the trade publications, they were interviewing various credit union managers, and his comment was, I'm not worried about fines because I file on time. So if you file on time, you don't have to worry about the fines.
If credit unions have some concerns about the online call report system, at the Credit Union Times, we've heard of some who are concerned about them, about the system. If they have, feedback, concerns, how can they go about reporting them to the NCUA, and will the NCUA take them into consideration?
Yes, we will take them into consideration. All they have to do is notify us what the problem is. If there are mitigating circumstances, we certainly will take that into consideration.
Well, I want to thank you for taking time. But before we conclude, the tie, there's the tie you're wearing today.
Yes.
You brought up at the meeting has some significance. Could you talk about that?
I did. This is a very special tie, Nick. It was created under the John Hopkins program for children who have cancer. And the designer of this tie is Emily Yang, who's a 13-year-old daughter of one of our employees here at NCUA. Emily is not only a very talented individual, but she's a cancer survivor. She designed this tie. She's a vibrant person. She's got a great personality and was just recently made an ambassador for John Hopkins. I liken this tie to the everything that these kids give back to us, how they inspire us by the fact that they have cancer and yet they're growing up in this very difficult world. It's hard enough to be a kid, but then to carry the fact that you have cancer with you and to fight it, they are an inspiration to all of us. So I told Emily when I got this tie that I would wear it at the January board meeting in honor of her and all survivor cancers, especially children. And if any of your viewers would like to buy a tie like this, it's available at Joseph Banks, and all the proceeds go to help children who have cancer.
Well, thank you for providing that information. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Nick.
And thanks for your time.
Thank you very much.
In Alexandria, Virginia, at the NCUA headquarters, I'm Nicholas Balassi, and thanks for watching.